There have been many madmen in America's darkest history, but few have been able to accomplish the sheer magnitude of evil that Jim Jones engineered. More than 900 men, women, and children lost their lives at his hand. Some survived, including Jim's own sons, and they told the world the horrifying story of the People's Temple, Jonestown, and the hundreds of lives lost there under Jim Jones' mystifying presence. James Jones gave his eager listeners at the People's Temple a hint of what he had planned in 1975 when he told them, "I love socialism, and I'm willing to die to bring it about. But if I did, I'd take 1,000 with me." That's exactly what happened 2 years later. More than a third of the group Jones talked into taking their own lives in the Jonestown were children. It's known as one of the worst mass incidents in American history. Jim Jones first stepped into the church as an impoverished child. His father was ill and his mom worked a lot. So young Jim roamed the streets, often hungry, to stay away from his sadly derelict home. Elderly widows would feel sorry for him and invite him in for cake and cookies. He quickly learned to recite scripture and verse at every denomination in town. Jim was an avid reader and made good grades in school. He stood out from other kids because he always wore suits and had his hair impeccably parted. He had odd habits like giving roadkill elaborate eulogies and preaching fiery sermons to forest animals. Jim graduated with honors and went to work at a hospital where he met his future wife, Marceline. They married in 1949 and began developing interests in civil rights and socialism. He began an assistant preaching position in 1952. He developed a theatrical performance style to draw in the most parishioners and made faith healing part of the event. Soon, every church in Indiana was calling Jim Jones to come preach for them. Reverend Jim Jones opened his church in 1954 in Indianapolis and became well known for his sermons on racial equality in an era when that wasn't often heard from a white preacher. It went through several names before finally landing on the People's Temple. He insisted his congregation be integrated and black people sit up front, a move that caused a rift with the highly segregated church administration, which prompted Jim to begin his own type of religion. Jim and Marceline worked tirelessly for civil rights. In 1960, Jim was recognized by the Indianapolis mayor for his work in desegregating the city. Throughout the 60s, the couple adopted 3 Korean children and, along with their other children of mixed heritages, called them his rainbow family. He encouraged his parishioners to also adopt from war-torn countries. As the 70s approached, Jim became increasingly distrustful of the government and told his congregation that a nuclear fallout was near and they must relocate to California to survive it. In the summer of 64, Jim, Marceline, their family, and 140 parishioners pulled up stakes and moved to Ukiah, California. Ukiah is the county seat and largest city of Mendocino County, California. Jim and his crew worked tirelessly to build up the new church. The grounds included childcare, a swimming pool, elderly care facilities, and a ranch. Jim would send buses out to bring people to church and visit neighboring areas to gain new members for his congregation. The People's Temple gained popularity with incredible speed during the 70s, but also received its first taste of negative media attention. The San Francisco Examiner claimed he was a fake prophet and scam artist. In 1973, several important members of the congregation stepped down and publicly announced suspicions that Jim made financial discrepancies, brainwashed parishioners, and participated in tax evasion. That's when Jim decided it was time for his church to get out of the United States. So he bought 27,000 acres in Guyana, packed up his church, and left. The first members of the People's Temple arrived in Guyana in 1973. In a year, there were 50 settlers at the new Guyana property. They worked day and night to clear the jungle and build Jonestown, where the congregation would live. It was meant to be a Garden of Eden, a paradise, without social problems. But that dream passed away, leaving only a nightmare. In 1977, 1,000 more People's Temple parishioners left California and joined their congregation in Guyana.
And set up a little town, an actual community or a country of our own where we can live the way we like to live with our own lifestyle.
In the early months, the hard work and utopian dreams of the congregation kept everyone happy, bonded together over their world dream.
It's the most beautiful place I've ever been in all my life. There's so many wonderful things about it.
It didn't take long before Jim showed his true colors. He placed armed guards around the compound. No one was allowed to leave. People who had defected back in the U.S. started suing Jim Jones for custody of their children they left behind, too scared to run with them. The U.S. government was lodging more complaints against Jim, even in Guyana, and he soon realized his distant location would be of little safety. He started depriving the congregation of sleep, waking them in the middle of the night for long, rambling sermons. He split couples apart and even placed their children with other parents. Furthermore, he did anything and everything he could to break the will of the people in his congregation. Back in the U.S., Congress was getting pressure to start an investigation into the People's Temple, and Congressman Leo Ryan took up the challenge. On November 15, 1978, Congressman Ryan, reporters, and some family of People's Temple members flew into Guyana to see firsthand what the situation was about. Jim knew they were coming, and he prepared each member at gunpoint, coaching them on what they could and could not say to the congressmen and reporters.
There were people with guns and rifles surrounding the assembly.
Members knew if they said or did anything Jim didn't like, there would be severe penalties later. The first night the congressman and his crew were at Jonestown, everything went well. The people held a reception for him and told of how great life was there. Congressman Ryan was genuinely impressed at what he saw. Late into the night, however, one of the residents passed a note to a reporter. He wanted to leave Guyana with the congressman's party. It turned out many did. Jim said anyone who wanted to leave was free to go. But when one of his followers lunged at a reporter with a blade, everyone just wanted to leave fast. People were filing out of Jonestown and rushing to the congressman's side, eager to get out of Guyana as fast as possible. Jim just snapped. He couldn't live with the fact that his kingdom was tumbling down around him. He sent a truck full of armed guards to gun down the congressman and four others as they boarded the plane to the safety of the United States. Jim told his followers what they had done and explained that the government would soon be on its own way to annihilate the People's Temple. As such, they all had to drink the tainted Kool-Aid Jim had his most trusted followers mix up. 914 people drank the Kool-Aid after Jim told them all the horrific things that would happen to them, their children, and their elderly loved ones when American soldiers arrived. Of course, none of it was true, but it worked. Jim Jones and his inner circle are the last to go. Jim is found with a bullet in his head. Roughly 85 people survived this vile sector of human history, including two of Jim Jones' sons, Stephen and Jim Jones Jr., because they happened to be away from the rest of the congregation that day. Right after the incident, a reporter asked Jim Jones' only surviving biological son, Stephon Jones, how he thought history would eventually come to see his father. "I don't care," was his reply. Do you think Jim was ever genuine, or was his whole facade just an illusion? What made him so charismatic that 914 people drank the Kool-Aid. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. Hit subscribe so you'll always have the new content.